Ben O'Connor, I'm from Emergent Space Technologies, and we're based here, we're based in, or here at Greenbelt. We are, the company was started in Greenbelt. We got here, Matthew Rushman over there, and Kevin Gordon, and they, we've all got projects going on, based on CPAP. So we're going to try and, you know, talk very quickly through all of the projects that we've got going. We've got about 52 employees right now. Like I said, we're based in Greenbelt. Operations in Austin, in Denver, Mountain View, and Albuquerque. Our core capabilities, we do a lot of flight and ground software development, systems engineering, and so forth. So the company, we do a lot of work for NASA, but we do work outside of NASA too. And it turns out that we came to the space world through our work for DoD. So we actually came from IAB and we're looking for a platform like the CFS and found it. So it answered a lot of it solved a lot of problems for us. Okay, so we're very agile. We started out our software development processes that way. We got our agile processes certified CMML maturity level 3. We've been reviewed at that level, and we're about to get audited again in the next few months. We got our renewal again. And that actually worked out very well for DoD. They really liked the agile process, and it worked in very well with their development schedule. We have multiple ongoing projects in CFS. One is completed. I'm going to talk about that. And we have two currently completed. Kevin talk about those two. And then we have one more about to start, but I can't talk about it. Yeah, hopefully next year. We use distributed teams. Our teams are spread out all over our offices all over the country. We use online tools to do collaboration and so forth. Our actual focus, we tend to be service oriented, and we tend to be NIST and space. We actually wrote our first application, the classified application, outside of CFS, didn't have anything to do with CFS for the first year and a half of its development. But it was benefit based and service based, and it turned out that fit the CFS model pretty well. The last thing is that, you know, we really try and exceed our customers' expectations. That's one of our things, and that's actually why we decided to go to CFS. It was a competitive edge for us. We needed to deliver software to DoD. We had an issue where the platform that we were developing our software for, the funding was cut for that. But the funding for our software was continued. So we needed to continue development, and it turned out CFS did that bill. So three projects that we got completed ongoing. The CLI application, which was developed for DARPA System F6, and that's a software package for onboard maneuvering and relative navigation. And there was the special architecture for fault isolation and paper. That's Matthew's project. It's a fitter framework for components, subsystems. And then on the application satellite software, which is those two are both phase SBIR. So those are multi-year development projects, sort of in the middle of their phase twos right now. They are funded through NASA. The other two are funded by DARPA. So starting with six phase, we develop for a system of it's going to be four satellites. The four are going to have wireless cross links for data. The system was supposed to be a resource sharing system, and this was, you know, 4 or 5 years ago now when DARPA started this project. So you can see how the software bus network might fit into that, right? There was going to be a message based operating system that had. That you can make calls across the satellites and use resources on different satellites. That was going to have a seamless message Pub sub message system built into it. Like I said, that was funded for about a year or so before its funding was de-scoped, and had a really, really good graphic-based development environment. It had a graphical way of defining messages, of defining components and their publications of subscriptions, the deployment on different processors, and different spacecraft. So they kind of a vision of where we might want to go for an IDE or CFS in the future. Also, that system, the S6OS, was as an ARINC 653 partitioned operating system and was going to be open source. It's been pushed a little bit down the line. I don't think it's real time. It definitely was developed fairly well, far along. Anything about this project is DARPA intended it from the beginning to be open source. So all over here, the intent was for it to become part of the community, and that's still the intent of our software. And that's one of the reasons we're here today is we're trying to find a home for that software. You know, it wasn't developed for CFS, but we ended up porting it to CFS, and now it's, you know, sort of pretty much native to CFS. And we need to find a home for that software, and we're hoping to see it used in the future. And I'm thinking one, I want to get to these slides. The System S6 cluster flight application onboard software, it was semi-autonomous. It's station keeping of multiple satellites in the cluster. It can do ingress and egress, collision avoidance, and also had a navigation package. So it could do enhanced relative navigation. It allows you to fly the cluster in relatively close location. At its peak, this project was 19 people and went on for about 3.5 years. A lot of people are here, four or five of our people here that worked on that. Alan Brown was working for us at that time, so he worked on that project as well. The components that we developed, five distinct components, and this is sort of a cluster flight software application that's composed of multiple components that work together. So we had the cluster flight manager, which was the coordinating agent for all of the other parts, an orbit maintenance service, a maneuver planning service, the navigation service, and a maneuver monitoring service. And I'll kind of go into how those pieces do in just a sec. This is what I deployed. So we have 4 spacecraft. So this is just a notional deployment. Spacecraft 1, spacecraft 2, spacecraft 3, spacecraft 4, and the ground node. We kind of they had a notion that the message bus extended all the way to the ground. So the ground subscribed the messages from the onboard spacecraft. We have these one-off services like cluster flight manager. You just have to appear once in the constellation somewhere. The maneuver planning service and the orbit maintenance services also just had to appear once in the constellation. You might put those on a node that had the processor. Each of the sites had the CNDH interface. So this whole system is outside of the CNDH and was sort of talking to the CNDH from outside an aviation component that was on each of the satellites in the cluster. Flow navigation provided information to the cluster flight manager. The cluster flight manager was meant to be autonomous. It was commanded from the ground. It was told what orbit to use the ground on each of the sites in. And then the cluster flight manager would work with the maintenance service and the maneuver planning service to maintain those satellites in that orbit. So if you had that required multiple satellites flying in either a loose cluster or in a formation, this software would allow that to operate semi-autonomously. The maneuvers themselves are managed in this component, and they are they're fed to the CNDH as needed. So the maneuvers were planned here. DARPA projects, we don't have the big bucks that a NASA program would have, so we use the autocoder instead of Simulink. We had, so we were autocoding, the algorithm software is being autocoded. Then we had the component code was all in C++, and that was all blended into the final code. We also had a simulation with NASA's trick, so we developed the software so that we could test it with a trick environment. We got help from Lori's group, we got help from JSC, we got help from Goddard on getting this project together. We still use trick as the simulation tool, and I don't know why I'm using laser there. But that was just developed the test environment that we use. I'm also at the University of Texas Aerospace Department, so it's weird to look out and see everybody awake. Here, this is an edge graphic. You can see it's a rotating frame where we have two satellites already in their orbits right here in the center, and they're in their cluster orbits where we want them. And these two out here are in holding orbits, and we are the software is getting committed. I want you to put that satellite in this orbit. So we tell what orbit we want it to go into. The software calculates the maneuvers and maneuvers it into that formation. And this other one eventually will decide it needs to go to. So that's essentially what the software does. It's doing an enhanced relative navigation, but maybe it's monitoring the orbits of the satellite and planning maneuvers for them to maintain this form of this cluster that we want them to maintain. Again, this software as an application, a group of components we expect in the next year are released to the open source community. Okay. So we think this would be an asset for future multi-spacecraft missions. We already released the apps individually. Where are they going to go? That's kind of what we're going to talk about. And hopefully there'll be a home for it relatively soon. I'm going to turn to Matthew. Matthew's going to talk about our This is Dr. Matt Rushman, who is setting up our fault detection and isolation recovery framework development.
Talking about the SAFER project that we've been working on in Emergent. Like Brendan covered, stands for Separable Architecture for Fault Isolation and Recovery. Just an overview of what SAFER is. SAFER is going to be a better for systems of systems with air communication. So our original application and what we're using for right now in the phase two SIBR is a fitter of guidance, navigation, and control for a cluster spacecraft. It came out of the work that we did on the CFA. Approach is to create a service-based architecture so it'll be more flexible to new missions. Develop hierarchical architecture to promote robustness better. At the end of the project are a reference implementation of SAFER that runs on CFE, demonstration of FITR for GN and C of a cluster of four satellites. Slide here shows the architecture of our simulation. We've deployed CFE or CFS on hummingboards running Linux. A hummingboard is similar to a Raspberry Pi. It has a significantly better processor. Because SAFER itself doesn't require the better processor, but as well as running on all these humming boards, we also have the CFA application and simulated communication outages between the different modules so that we can understand how communication and outages affect safer. Because, you know, the problem we realize is that when you have systems that are communicating, you don't want your fault detection system detecting false alarms when communication goes down, because that's kind of a normal scenario. These connected to a trick simulation or a laptop over Ethernet. It's all the dynamics. This is a basic overview of the way we've configured our safer architecture for GNNC. I mentioned the hierarchy is kind of laid out on the right of this diagram. We have level, system level, and subsystem level. Save time, I'll just skip explaining all those. So what we're working with is a fitter for the GPS, setting the relative range sensing, and the thruster spacecraft. So the spacecraft sensing and actuation. Different other algorithms over on the right report their health to the diagnosis component. And especially some of the cluster level algorithms, depending on how the communication has been working, maybe reporting things, it's the responsibility to see information from the different sources and isolate the fault. And that reports itself to the recovery system, which handles commanding the recovery action. So, we're working for a GNNC of a 4 satellite cluster. All right, so we've imagined that it could be expandable to other systems in the future. So on the left, we could integrate different platforms such as US rovers or spacesuits. Right, insert the new mission-specific detection algorithms that you would need for those new systems, sensors, and actuators. In the middle, the disaster recovery component are configurable, the new resolution and recovery. How we deploy the CFP coming forward. Basically, to summarize this, we have five deployments. Four of those deployments are similar deployments on all four spacecraft. Those are the services that need to be run on every single spacecraft. And then some of the CFA services only want to run on one spacecraft and they're on a separate deployment. And those are the ones that are hogging all the CPU. So we can put them on there. A quick summary of some of the highlights. We deployed CFE on the four hummingboards running Linux. Which is a safer component, running a CFE application on the hummingboard. The communication outages between the first hummingboard using a Linux IP table and the command when the outages should occur. We did a day run of the S6 cluster flight application on these hummingboards in real time. Turned out to be very successful. Safer yet for that long of a time because we need work for testing and development, so safer yet. But we have run safer for 1 month in a faster than real time simulation without any false alarms. So that's good news. And safer running on the desktop in our office. You can see the four boards. But John's over there, he's a part of the team that's been working with me. I've had several engineers who helped out recently.
All right, so mentioning Kevin Gordon from my lab, based to SP Iowa, a little bit more halfway through the program. Have one of the principal investigators here is Dr. Karen Delaney. We have another PhD in Albuquerque working in engineering. All right, to the details of the program, hopefully, have opportunity next year and I can talk about that. I'll talk about experience with PFE for, you know, the want to buy those now. 2 minutes.
Oh, okay.
Good. Maybe this apply it personally, I don't know what the problem so, you know, benefit of this is going into this program, it only started a couple months after the aspect CFA ended. We had 6 months experience recording it. So, the CFP, the CFS, here are the key ways from our experience. You know, I was hoping that we'll talk about C++ and Josh and Lewis. It happens. Although we do have just one entry point in C for each one of the software components. So, what is that real quickly? Basically, two software components, one of them that controls sensors and or processes the data, and then the other one that controls the hardware. And those can be deployed on all of them, and then there's a whole spacecraft, foster system, spacecraft. The CFS is an abstraction itself. We've taken that one step further by abstracting our software components from the CFS itself. I'll show you that in a minute. Since the old has the ITalk and the command in Jazz and the telemetry on that, we have a full base with that. Okay, we did have a SIM working just after 2 weeks of the program start that kind of shows us experience with it. It's about 4 different deployments. We have to modify the OSAL, the startup. Maybe that's fixed by the rate condition correction, but our experience was we had to modify after. With these two versions. We procured flight light hardware, get everything running within 1 month. I think it's just like a tool chain and whatnot, and figuring out the problem. Second piece of hardware, this dual port A9, I think we had it working in 1 day. Pretty good. Design our own. Software network, mainly to be along our C++. There's something we call it emergent software bus network for lack of a better name. You did add some, I put a fitter in the quotes, kind of an application layer for, you know, we've got Canadian reach line. We also have boxes to deal with large software bus messages. This real, this is talking about how we abstract it away. So on the right, in this vertical bar, there are pure apps. I'm not going to name them. This point matter. We have kind of a sense of CFS app here that access chapters. Our chapters where all the functionality is here. And all the communication is done with C++. Off message off. So this is just, you know, pretty deep. We're calling C++. Everything is very object oriented, getting all the messages. This is just kind of a design for ESD. It acts as all across a single C entry point here. This is a map, and I have these two colors for kind of half in, half out. So it doesn't matter how many peers we have, you know, which instantiate other objects. And then this side could be replaced very cleanly with another interface. The same thing. The messages on the right side are pure. Software component on the top is the messaging. This just kind of shows how it gets translated. So, a message object instance reference to it would be has an actual parameter in the C++ call to and from app, which translates into the C structure and then the software bus message. It's just, you know, command inductive out and new sockets and there's, you know, software bus and mission out. But like the benefit of the community, the takeaway was really, you Any questions?